Revelation, as I've said before, is the principal book of prophecy in the New Testament of the Bible.
David with Gerald Fleury.
Greetings, everyone. Both political parties in the U.S. will have some people who dislike or perhaps hate the Constitution, but it seems like today most of those people come from what we call the radical left and don't have a good opinion of the Constitution of the United States at all. Now, is there a problem with that, and what does it all mean? If people hate the Constitution and want to do away with it, is that a big problem, or is it nation-destroying, as many people believe? What is it going to produce? The Constitution itself says that it is the supreme law of the land. The supreme law of the land. Now, if you do away with the supreme law of the land, as some are saying we should do, well, what is that going to bring? Is it going to bring anarchy and chaos? And is it really dangerous to this entire land and to everybody who lives here in America? If you look at the Old Testament and our forefathers in the book of Joshua and Judges, it's all really one book, and it says there at the very end that every man did that which was right in his own eyes. He didn't have a law to look to, and everybody just made up their mind how they were going to live and what they were going to do, and just after that, Israel was conquered. So what kind of leadership can you possibly have if you don't have some law and somebody there to implement the law? Now, Abraham Lincoln believed strongly in the Constitution and fought a civil war to preserve that Constitution, and we lost thousands and thousands of lives. It was all about the Constitution. And Mr. Lincoln talked about that often. Now, he said he knew there were bad laws, but you go ahead and you keep the Constitution just the way it is until you can, by the Constitution, change those bad laws. But do it constitutionally, he said. And that's what he did, and many people have called him the greatest president that we have. So we do have quite a history there that we need to look to, but this is your country, and this is, as we make changes like that, it's going to influence and have everything to do with your life. And the stakes are awfully high. If you look at the supreme law of the land, and if it's taken away, well, what is going to replace it? What is there that's going to replace it? I personally believe the Constitution of the United States is one of the most noble documents on this earth ever created by man. And I'll show you a little more about why I believe that as we go along here. But it is popular these days to be challenging the Constitution and saying we should get rid of it. This is a long New York Times article, December the 20th, 2012. The title of the article is "Let's Give Up on the Constitution" by Lewis Michael Seidman. And here is how he opens the article: "As the nation teeters at the edge of fiscal chaos, observers are reaching the conclusion that the American system of government is broken. But almost no one blames the culprit, our insistence on obedience to the Constitution. With all the archaic idiosyncratic and downright evil provisions. Now, what does the Constitution really have to do with the fiscal chaos? I mean, that's a weakness of character in men, not in a document or not in a law, because they're not following financial laws. But that's what he says. He goes on to say, as someone who has taught constitutional law for almost 40 years, I am ashamed it took me so long to see how bizarre all this is. Now, there obviously have been is evil in any age, and Abraham Lincoln had to use, really, the Constitution to destroy slavery and that terrible evil. But he did it according to the Constitution. Other people had twisted the Constitution to their own way of thinking, but Abraham Lincoln brought us back into the supreme law of the land, where this law applies to every man, to the Gentile, the Israelite, every man. And that is the way the Constitution reads, if you're an American citizen. This professor was also on CBS News, and he was asked, is the U.S. Constitution truly worthy of the reverence in which most Americans hold it? A view on that from Lewis Michael Seidman, professor of constitutional law at Georgetown University. Well, he said, I've got a simple idea. Let's give up on the Constitution. And he goes on to say, he's not talking about every part of it, but once you start doing away with, let's say, a large segment of it, the way he's talking about it, leads to the destruction of the whole document. That's just the way things tend to go. And everything tends toward lawlessness if you look at human nature as it is without anybody trying to control it. But he talked about it. We should not be keeping it because of a bunch of people who are now long dead favored them two centuries ago. But then on the other hand, if you look at the Ten Commandments of the Bible, many people still believe in that document, which was given to us around 6,000 years ago. So it's still a very good document because it was established by God and by the people who loved God and knew God and knew the Bible as it was at that time. This article goes on to say, this is our country. This is just a CBS News report. This is our country. We live in it, he says, and we have a right to the kind of country we want. We would not allow the French or the United Nations to rule us, and neither should we allow people who died over two centuries ago and knew nothing of our country as it exists today. Well, now, there's a wrong focus here, I believe, and I think you could see that as well. If we are to take back our country, he says, we have to start making decisions for ourselves and stop deferring to an ancient and outdated document. Now, one of the Supreme Court justices agrees with that. Is it right or is it wrong? Or is it nation-destroying, as some people say? Will it destroy the Republic of America? What's wrong with that reasoning, if there's anything wrong with it? Or what is the flaw in that reasoning? We can't very well sit on the sidelines when you're talking about the supreme law of the land. We can't just sit here and do nothing. Everybody needs to be concerned. But I'll tell you one thing that our forefathers understood a lot better than we do today. They understood the Bible a lot better. They understood God a lot better. They understood the rule of law a lot better. And they understood human nature far better than we do today. Far better. And I can show you a little of that today, and we'll give you literature to absolutely prove it to you, that is a fact. Now, our forefathers were, in a sense, when they came from Britain, as far as their religious freedom concerned especially, were living in a kind of slavery themselves. They couldn't worship the way they wanted to. They couldn't speak out the way they wanted to and felt that they had the right to do. And so they came to this country and they wanted to establish a constitutional document that would give them freedom from tyranny, freedom from human nature running rampant. Now let me just read something to you here in a moment. But if you again think about the prophets and apostles of the Bible, they look at all that they established that we still follow today, because it is something that they look to God to get. And the Constitution is the same to some degree, to a large degree, as a matter of fact. But these apostles and prophets knew God. They knew the Ten Commandments. But you see, this Constitution is not easy to hold on to. And even the forefathers knew that people would come along and challenge the document. Benjamin Franklin said, "We've given you a republic if you can keep it." But are you willing? Do we have lots of people that are willing to fight and die even for the Constitution the way they did in the beginning to establish it? And they spilled their blood to establish this document because they so wanted freedom from tyranny and freedom from human nature that would like to believe they know how to rule. Human nature believes it knows how to rule everything. And it, in fact, knows how to rule nothing. If you look at God's Word, that is what it says. This Seidman wrote the book on constitutional disobedience, and he asked, well, why should we care about what the Constitution says? Why should we even care about it? Well, why should we even care about any law? How about any financial law? Let's just go and spend like everything you have into the over $16 trillion of debt. The problem is not a document. The problem is not keeping laws. That's about not keeping financial laws. 2 + 2 = 4. And yet we want to blame a document for that instead of ourselves, instead of our own human nature, which we all have and need to overcome. That's the whole plan of the Bible. But that is America's foundational document. It is the foundation of our republic. What are we going to do when it's gone? I'm going to show you how deadly dangerous that thinking is. And this is not a political statement, because you have people coming from both sides that are very critical of the Constitution. But if you have to be careful, or there'll be rulers that will take away your religious freedom, your freedom of speech, and all the other freedoms that we enjoy. The New York Times wrote in April 2012, "Increasingly in recent months, the administration has been seeking ways to act without Congress." Or they might add, without the Constitution, because you're not supposed to act without Congress. They have everything to do with enforcing that document. It's not just for the executive branch. It's for the legislature and the judicial branch. They all work together to give us success in our nation and real rule that is fair to everyone. And that is what the Constitution teaches. Notice what the famous British historian Paul Johnson wrote. Quote, this was December 26, 1999 in the Sunday Telegraph. And he said, "The rule of law, as distinct from the rule of a person or a class of a people," in other words, do you want the rule of a law or the rule of a person or a group of people? You better think about that, because I'll tell you this, the Bible says that you should live according to a document, and so does the Constitution. And it has been oh so successful for some 200 years. But anyhow, it talks about, or you could be ruled by a class of people, he says, or as opposed to the rule of force, is an abstract, sophisticated concept. It is mighty difficult to achieve. But until it is achieved and established in the public mind with such vehemence that masses of individuals are prepared to die to uphold it, just as our forefathers were willing to die to establish it. I mean, you have to really believe in something to do that. Do our people today believe in the Constitution to that degree? Oh, it seems to me we're falling short there. It does indeed. He goes on to say, no other form of progress can be regarded as secure. The Greeks had tried to establish the rule of law but failed. The Romans had succeeded under the Republic, but Caesar and his successors had destroyed it. The essence of the rule of law is impersonality, omnipotence, and ubiquity. It is the same law for everyone, every person. Well, you see, that's where if you're going to have some kind of slavery, if that's not the way it is, you're going to have some kind of slavery for everyone that is denied that. He concludes, everywhere, kings, emperors, high priests, the state itself are subject to it. If exceptions are made, the rule of law begins to collapse. That was the grand lesson of antiquity. That was it. The grand lesson was right there. And we have to learn from history. You better look back at history and see how many people tried to establish the rule of law and could not do it or could not sustain it. They couldn't maintain it. And today, I'll tell you, we're in, a lot of confusion. And really, I'll say to you that that's our only security is establishing and maintaining that document. If we lose that, you're going to see anarchy and chaos and violence like you've never seen in this country. What's to stop it? There's no law to stop it. There might be tyranny to stop some of it, but is that going to enslave you? Would you be willing to die for a lot of confusion? You see, Mr. Johnson said this, both in Virginia and New England, to the north, the colonists were determined, God-fearing men. Mr. Johnson wrote, often in search of a religious toleration denied them at home. They were slaves in a sense. In that sense, who brought their families and were anxious to farm and establish permanent settlements, they put political and religious freedom before riches. Thus took shape the economic dynamo that eventually became the United States, an experiment designed to establish the rule of God on earth. What's that? The rule of God on earth? These are the people that created the Constitution. They really wanted, many of them wanted to establish the rule of God on this earth. And they wrote this Constitution, and a lot of it is based on the Bible and Ten Commandments. And so those people who want to destroy the Constitution also, well, they don't have a high opinion of the Bible either, and they don't like God telling them what to do, if they even believe in God. So, well, where does that leave us? Does it leave us not at their mercy or at their mercy? Well, let me read to you what Earl Warren said when he was talking about religion and morality being the basis, really, of the Constitution, that you really do have to have a deep belief in God or you can't maintain it. But he said this in 1954, Supreme Court Chief Justice Earl Warren wrote, I believe the entire Bill of Rights came into being because of the knowledge our forefathers had of the Bible and their belief in it. You see, that's where our forefathers were much superior than we are today. We talk about the Bible, but how much do we believe in it? They believed in it. Now, they didn't every single one believe in it, but overall they did. Now, the politicians today, well, I don't think they measure up nearly like the politicians anciently or our forefathers. Those men who were politicians had more faith in the Bible than our religious people do today, for the most part. That is the truth. We wrote in our booklet on the Freedom Without Law, the Constitution is the foundation of our republic, and the Ten Commandments were in many ways the foundation of the Constitution. Now, again, it was just in principle in most cases, but we're talking about a spirit of working against law here and lawlessness entering into the land more and more, whether it be Canada or Britain or Australia or New Zealand or the Jewish people in the Middle East. There is too much of that spirit that is plaguing these countries. Too much of it that is causing all kinds of problems, and the rule of law is not doing well in those countries. And God has a lot to say about it in the Bible, if you know anything about Bible prophecy. But the forefathers shed their blood, streams of blood flowed because they were fighting to establish the Constitution, if you will, that document, so they could have freedom and they could keep the government off their backs and keep them away when they tried to have their way and thought they had a better idea. Those people that talk about doing away with the Constitution don't really have an idea about, well, what is going to replace it? What do you do when you take away the rule of law? What do you do when you take away the police? Do you think you might have a breakdown of society? Well, it really is the same principle. But our forefathers fought en masse and gave their lives, many of them, for the freedoms that we enjoy today. And men will sit and be very critical when they don't know much about that. They don't understand it. They think they do, but I tell you they don't, because there's a spirit there that is deadly dangerous to you as an individual and to your country. Would you or I be willing to die for the Constitution? Well, I don't think too many would. The Constitution was based to a great extent on God's law. That is a fact. So if the Constitution, the Supreme Court justices, for example, they're just chosen for life. They're subject not to anybody except the Constitution. It's just the Constitution itself that they're subject to. They're supposed to obey that document, and if they get to the point where they begin to change it because they think it ought to be changed and not doing it constitutionally, they're just acting like tyrants. That's all it amounts to. It's very simple. We needn't complicate this. It's really very simple. They want to rewrite the Constitution in all too many cases. And of course, as Mr. Robert Bork, who recently died, said that the big trump card in American politics is the Constitution. Oh, everybody wants to control or change the Constitution to the way they want it, but not necessarily go through Congress and the judicial and the executive branches to do that. They just want to change it because they think they're right. They're just so sure they're right, but they do not know often what they're talking about. Robert Bork wrote this. He said, a well-known Harvard law professor, Mr. Bork wrote, turned to me with some exasperation and said, your notion that the Constitution is in some sense law must rest upon an obscure philosophic principle with which I am unfamiliar. But look, it says this. Here, let me read you something from the Constitution. This is from the Constitution itself, and it says, it shall be the supreme law of the land. This document shall be the supreme law of the land. Now look, I'll tell you, if you don't have the Constitution, you're going to have, let's say, we'll just say you're going to have human nature dictating what we should do. You're going to have Satan the devil dictating what we should do, the god of this world, 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 4. That's the real problem here. But I want to just, I don't have time to get into too much of this, but we have to make a choice. But look, you can look at Jeremiah 17 and verse 9, and here's what it says. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Now, those men that want to change the Constitution, they probably don't agree with that at all. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Now, who understands human nature? like that. After all, the god of this world is the devil. That's what your Bible says. And Revelation 12 and verse 9 says he deceives the whole world. Let me tell you, people think like the devil too much of the time unless they're fighting to overcome human nature. God says that your human heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. How many people believe that? And it says, goes on in verse 5 to say, you're under a curse if you follow a man. You should follow only God, never a man. That certainly includes myself. Don't follow me. That's not going to get you any place except in trouble. What you want to do is follow God. But look, if you start working your way around Congress and the judicial branch, well, then you're just eviscerating the Constitution. You're just disemboweling that document and tearing it apart. And without that supreme law, it's going to just bring violence and all kinds of evil into the social areas of our life. That's what's going to happen. But you see, God says, okay, he'll let us go and do a lot of these evil things, but he's about to come and stop this madness in this world and establish an even greater document than the Constitution of the United States. That's what we really look forward to. Until next week, this is Gerald Fleury. Goodbye, friends.
Many politicians and scholars are calling for abandoning the Constitution of the United States. But what would that decision mean for society? To understand, please request our two free booklets, No Freedom Without Law and The Ten Commandments. As you will see, without the rule of law, society is left to the rule of tyrants. The Constitution was founded largely on the Ten Commandments. God gave ten basic laws to mankind on how to live. Many people scoff at God's commandments, but do you know that God gave them to ensure human happiness? Are the commandments to be observed today, or has God's law been done away with? Discover the true meaning and intent of the Ten Commandments. Then you will also see how the Constitution is necessary to protect your individual rights and freedoms. Request our two free booklets, No Freedom Without Law and the Ten Commandments. Also, ask for a free subscription to our monthly news magazine, The Philadelphia Trumpet. Don't miss our newest issue, which gives much insight into the recent events within Europe and the Vatican. This is an issue you can't afford to miss. Also, visit us online at thetrumpet.com for daily columns and news update videos. There you will see our From the Editor section, which includes weekly web-exclusive videos from Key of David presenter Gerald Fleury. Request our two free booklets, No Freedom Without Law and The Ten Commandments. You will also be sent a free subscription to The Trumpet magazine. All our literature is free and will be sent to you with no cost or obligation. Order your free literature now. Oh,